What's good, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Fun with Dumb. Today, I'm joined by my co-host, Rick Lee.
Yes, sir.
And we have guests that are chefs, foodies. I'm surrounded by the three food content related that I consume. I consume the most food related content online through these three, I think, currently. Of course, one of our big brothers, Roy Choi, is co-hosting with. I asked Roy Choi to co-host with us since he's somebody we've always been in contact with, someone we admire, and he's always supporting like new generation chefs, content creators, food influencers. Thanks for coming on the show, Roy.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I'm good. Good to be here. I was just thinking, right. I was like, trying to think of something clever. Like, we call this episode The Pear and Not The Bear.
Yeah, yeah, right? Yeah, yeah. We'll think of it as a show we'll go around.
My jokes never hit because these guys are words.
Nah.
They're so good. They're so quick.
We love you, Roy. Roy is also an author, a chef who's really, you know, done some amazing stuff in Los Angeles and globally. And I feel like this guest that we have today is doing like the next generation version of all of that.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's just high quality content. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. You might recognize on Instagram as Twaydabae. This is Twaywin.
Let's go.
Hello.
Let's
go. Yeah. What's up?
Oh, the pageant wave.
And she just put out a new book called Dion. It's a cookbook. Great quality, great
Thank
recipes,
you.
Representing the Vietnamese, not the Vietnamese, or I saw the little content piece you made where people mispronounce.
It's so funny because they don't even realize that they're mispronouncing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they're just like, "What? I just said Vietnamese. What do you mean?"
What did it say? Did they say Vietnamese? Like with an M?
Yeah, Vietnamese.
Vietnamese.
Yeah.
I get that. Yeah. I guess it's hard for some.
Wait, hold on. That's the wrong way to say it.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the wrong way to say
Shut
it.
Up.
It's yeah, Vietnamese.
No. Okay, gotcha.
Because it's Vietnam.
Vietnamese is one of my favorite words to say, to be honest with you.
Why?
As a rapper, the syllable count and the flow.
I will say Vietnamese sounds like it is in Vietnamese.
if you say
Korean, it doesn't sound Korean.
No.
Like it,
oh, okay.
Unless you say Korean, then it sounds Korean. But if you just say Korean, like that almost sounds like it could be like a English word. Vietnamese sounds like the dialect.
Yeah, that's true. But then some people also say, well, when I speak it English, I say Vietnam. But people are like, it's Vietnam. And I'm like, whenever I say Vietnam, it sounds like back in Nam.
It's like Taekwondo.
Back in Nam.
Vietnam. Yeah,
sounds like you fought in the war against the Vietnamese.
Yeah,
for sure. Like, you know, like the last week I said kimchi and I said kimchi.
With the two E's, it sounded crazy.
They were roasting me because it sounded like I was talking about it like it's a martial art.
Yeah.
I practice kimchi.
If it was like a movie, it would come out in that script, in that Charlie Chan script.
Yeah, exactly. The old racist font. Yeah. Tway, I love your content. I'm a big fan. I get introduced to so much like Vietnamese foods through your thing because I feel like a lot of people are just familiar with like the hits.
Yeah, the pho and banh mi. That was like the goal when I first started this because I wanted to introduce to people that there's more to Vietnamese food than just pho and banh mi.
Yeah.
So I wanted to, you know, showcase the foods that I grew up, like my comfort foods that my mom cooked when I grew up eating it.
I was thinking about that a lot. Like Koreans and Vietnamese share similar perceptions in that you guys are known for just those two foods and then we're known for Korean barbecue and kimchi.
Yes.
But those are only like little like hangnails into our whole cuisine.
Yeah.
What's your number three, you think? What's the number three banger?
Number three banger? Bumbawe.
Bumbawe.
Bumbawe is like a really good one. Ban kuong, I don't know if you guys know those.
Nah.
It's like a rice roll. Okay. It's like the Chinese rice rolls, but instead of soy sauce, we eat it with fish sauce.
And the little crepe joints too.
Banh xeo. Or banh cot.
Yeah.
I like the small one.
The small ones is the banh cot. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That shit is so good.
So how about the rolls? Is that in the top five? Like spring rolls, veggies? Is that a thing?
It is. And I eat it all the time, but it's just like, I don't know. It's not
so
entry level.
Yeah.
Got you.
I got you. Yeah. I got you.
Yeah, I just realized how ignorant I am though. With the Vietnamese cuisine. I don't know anything.
Have you gotten into snails and the seven courses of beef?
Nah, the craziest the catfish, thing I did was the like the loaf of bread where you dip it into beef stew. Oh. Shaky beef, you know?
Shaky beef?
Everything I do is like Shaky beef.
Shaky beef, I like that better,
yeah.
It's like, you know, we go to pho before church. That was like our tradition back in Virginia.
Oh, wow.
And then every time you go to a pho restaurant, you always think that you're going to get something besides pho, but then you're like, nah, you got to go.
It's like their jajangmyeon.
You got to it's like the JJM, exactly.
What are your thoughts with pho and people putting like oyster sauce, hoisin, and sriracha into the broth?
I think it's great. I think it's whatever you want to do. It's your food. I'm not eating it. It's your food. You do it to how you like it.
Got you.
Yeah.
What's your move? Like, what do you... Because I always say, taste the broth first.
Yeah, you have to taste the broth first.
Taste the broth.
You have to taste the broth first. And then my move, I love a lot of limes. I'm a very, like, I love vinegary, sour stuff. Yeah. And so my soups, it has to be sour. Mm. So a lot of lime, a lot of sriracha, a fuck ton of herbs. That's it.
That's the one thing I do love about pho. It's a very interactive experience. Because I ask someone who doesn't cook.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm cooking. I chop these onions, you know?
It's
great. You do the little side dish of the...
I love taking pho first-timers to go because I have my way to do it, too. I ask for the onions. I ask for the kind of like the blanched bean sprouts or like the mung beans. And then I ask for that oil with that scallion piece in it. You know what I'm talking about? The beef fat.
Oh, the beef fat.
The beef fat, yeah. Just to add it just for that little umami boost. And the way that I do it, Zoe actually put me on. He does the 8-5, which is 8 circles of sriracha and 5 circles of hoisin. So that was...
8-5?
8-5.
That's funny.
Yeah,
and then you guys make a little kimchi out of it.
Make a little kimchi out of it, exactly.
Wait, have you ever had pickled garlic with your pho?
What?
Yeah. No. So in Vietnam, that's what they do. They have it at every single pho spot. It's pickled garlic, and you
could I ask for that? Would they?
I don't
it?
Know. That's why a lot of people here don't do it. I don't know why.
You might have to go deep, Orange County,
or make one and then just take a jar with you.
Heck yeah, that sounds crazy.
It's so good.
Where are you from, Twai?
I am from the south of Vietnam, so Vung Tau, which is like 2 hours south of Saigon.
Okay.
Yeah.
You were born there.
Mm-hmm. I was born there.
And when did you come to the States?
2006 when I was 8 years old.
Wow. Yeah. So you were a semi-fob, like a...
I'm like all the way fob. What do you
is
mean?
That
I did not know English.
That's 1.5.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think what... It is always interesting when I meet immigrants that came here around like that age or 11. Like Jimmy O Yang came here when he was 11.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like... And when he speaks English, I'm like... There's a little fob swag in there.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of a fob swag.
For sure. I don't necessarily
get that from you, but...
I learned English through watching a lot of TV and just reading. What I remember I would read out loud, but I wouldn't even know what I was reading. I just wanted to like enunciate words to sound like I was speaking English. And then when I would watch TV, I would repeat what they would say back.
Damn.
Yeah, no, so really I watched a lot of...
I mean, when I first met you, if I just met you briefly, I would never have known.
Really?
That you were a fob. But
no. Sometimes it comes out.
But as I got to know you more,
sometimes I see it as I talk to you
more. Yeah.
When you get angry?
I don't know. Sometimes I can't come up with English words because I'm like, what is that in English? I don't know.
I still feel like I have fob elements even in me. And I've been here since I was 3 years old. You know what I'm saying? But this episode is brought to you by ZocDoc. Have you guys found it to be a hassle to find a good doctor? Sometimes I've gotten sick and I had to rough through it probably longer than I had to because I want to avoid finding a doctor near me, calling them, see if the insurance is in a network. The whole thing is a hassle. It's so crazy that you can find a restaurant nearby that has high reviews, go through their reviews, get a reservation within minutes. But when it comes to a doctor, it has to be such a hassle. Well, you don't have to deal with that anymore because there's ZocDoc. ZocDoc has thousands of top-rated doctors and also they're listed with with verified patient reviews so you can find and book a doctor who not only has years of experience and an actual medical degree, but also gets you. ZocDoc is a free app where you can find amazing doctors and book appointments online. We're talking about booking appointments with thousands of top-rated patient-reviewed doctors and specialists. You can filter specifically for ones who take your insurance, are located near you, and treat almost any condition you're searching for. Go to ZocDoc.com/dumb, D-U-M-B, and download the ZocDoc app for free. Then find and book a top-rated doctor today. That's ZocDoc, ZocDoc.com/dumb, ZocDoc.com/dumb, D-U-M-B. These K-Town kids be throwing my English off.
Mm.
You know, they got like weird little pronunciations and cadences for some, oh my God, really? It's like, what the fuck? Why am I saying really like that? Or, oh my God, are you dumbfounded?
Like, dumbfounded.
Yeah. I'm like, why do you have that accent? Like, you're born here. Like, what did you watch growing up? Like, do you remember anything that you were imitating?
I watched a lot of SpongeBob.
SpongeBob.
And then I watched a lot of Anthony Bourdain because, I don't know, there was just something about his shows and the way that he loved Vietnam so much. I was like, oh, I like that. I like that you love my country.
Right.
I didn't even think about that, that Bourdain is probably one of the few places there was actually some sort of Vietnam, you know, visual.
Yes.
Beyond the war movies and stuff, of course.
Yes, like, that's why I loved his show because he just showed all the different parts of Vietnam and just the way that he spoke to the Vietnamese people. I was like, wow, I love this guy.
It does seem like just in recent time, like that Vietnamese representation is finally coming through beyond just war movies like Full Metal Jacket or Apocalypse Now. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, because that was like the only Vietnamese visual you would see on TV growing up.
Kind of categorized him in a box almost.
It was,
I mean, this year, the Darling of Sundance was that Dion. The movie.
No.
Aditi.
Aditi.
Yeah. Which is also the name of your restaurant in West Hollywood.
Yes.
You guys both are entrepreneurs in the restaurant business, which I don't know how you guys do. It seems like the hardest possible business to get into. Roy's like traumatized by his face.
And he still keeps on going. Yeah.
Trying
I love
to not open restaurants.
He's like, I don't even want to talk about this, fam. No, I get you because I have friends who own restaurants and I talk about this every day with them. They're really struggling.
Tedium.
And that business is really struggling. How has it been for you? Because it's your first year opening up a restaurant. How would you give your assessment of like your first year?
Ooh, I knew that it was going to be hard and difficult. I didn't realize it was going to be like that crazy. Mm. I think just like the fun part is coming up with the menu and coming up with the specials and all of that. But I think the hardest part is, you know, building a team that like you are trusting with your recipes, building a team that, you know, like building a an environment where it feels good to show up to work, and just like the employee retention rate is just like,
I feel like I've heard a similar thing, and I know you have so much experience with building teams for multiple businesses and restaurants that you've had. How do you balance that? Because one side I always hear is that the job market is really bad, people aren't getting hired for stuff, but the other side is like, I can't find the right person for this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is happening here, you know?
Well, as a restaurateur, it's part of your responsibility to develop the system so that team members, especially new team members that come in, can get it right, because sometimes you're not there. So sometimes as you're coming up as a young chef, your ego gets in the way, and like maybe in rapping too, you try to put too many syllables into too many words and all these things. But really, you have to understand as you grow older, these recipes have to be bulletproof and they have to be able to be replicated. So really a lot of that energy falls back on you. It's hard because not that we can't find people to work. It's just, there are so many nuances. Mm. It's a human business.
Yeah.
And so, it all depends on people performing, you know, and you kind of have to like orchestrate that every day.
Yeah.
So that's the nuance. That's hard, you know?
Yeah, bro, I watched one season of Bear. I couldn't watch it.
Yeah.
It's like anxiety driven. It's like culinary uncut gems, dude. Just constant stress,
yeah,
constant fighting, just like passive aggressiveness. I can't even imagine opening up a restaurant like that honeymoon season. It must be fun, like making the menus, but then just that longevity, you know? Yes. Just like once it plateaus and it's kind of like, all right, we need to keep this going in quality, consistency. It's got to be tough.
It's hard because it goes on forever, right?
Yeah.
So the thing is, everyday thing.
Let's say you guys come out with an album, but let's say it hits a plateau,
yeah,
right? Let's say it came out of the rocket ship.
Yeah.
But you can make another album, yeah, right? You can kind of like move beyond that. For a restaurant, you can't, right? So you have to constantly go back to that well and rewater that album that was already passed. And then reinvent it every
Yo,
time.
Yo, that's, you know, crazy.
And it's so, like they're on tour every day.
Every day. Every day.
Through the year. Through the year. Every night you're performing.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't let it kind of linger.
And one bad day can ruin the whole place.
Right.
You know, like you could be like running shit, like the hottest restaurant in LA. And if you have like one or two bad days, people just like stop going.
Yeah. Could I ask you guys how often or if you ever read your Yelp reviews?
Ooh.
I stopped reading Yelp.
You did?
Yeah. I can read comments and I can read, I'm a Pisces, so I'm really sensitive. So I can, I've created guardrails because I used to like, I almost like would break shit, but I can read comments now. I can read reviews a little bit. And then I can read what's out in the ether, but I can't really read Yelp too much. Mm-hmm. I'm getting back to it, though. I'm getting better with it. There was a period between like 2010 and 2019 I couldn't read Yelp.
Just take a break. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good. It's healthy. Yeah. How about you?
I do not read Yelp.
Not at all.
But I have, my team does. And what they do is like if there's like an ongoing problem or if there's like a like repeated something, then they'll bring it up.
Mm.
But if it's just like a troll or something like that, like they're not gonna bring it up.
You know where you could feel good about yourself? Like TripAdvisor.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's where you feel good. Yeah, you're all nice.
Oh, really?
Oh, five
star.
That. Okay, cool.
4.5 star. I love that place.
Wait, why is that?
I don't know, because I think it's just a very docile, very safe space, you know?
Like, gosh,
older,
hate Yelp.
A little bit older crowd.
Yelp is terrible.
Yelp is terrible.
They give too much power to just a.
So much power.
Just an everyday man, you know?
But there's a good side to Yelp. You know, like when you're looking for something or the people are really honest or supportive. You know, that part is good, but
I wish they did, like, you know how on Amazon, if you leave a review and you've purchased a verified purchase, I wish they would do that to Yelp, because for me, I feel like sometimes the Yelp reviews aren't even from people that have visited the restaurants. Mm-mm. It's just like people
Malicious
that
intent.
Are exactly
That's
that
crazy.
Have seen me on the internet for some reason, just doesn't like me and then goes and leaves a review.
Or like it's their way of flirting with you. You know what I mean?
How do you guys do on Reddit? Is Reddit a worse place than Yelp?
Reddit is so weird.
I get roasted on Reddit sometimes.
He got murdered.
Shout out to Reddit.
It's like we all know, being a public figure, you're putting yourself out there to be critiqued, judged on your authenticity, especially if you're a voice of a community.
Yeah.
Like I think all of us are in that way. I'm sure your authenticity and Vietnamese cuisine gets tested all the time, or your upbringing, right? And then someone goes to Didi, and when you're trying to do your own take on it, they're like, this isn't how my grandma made it. It's like, duh.
That's the point.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I mean, I think it's tough, and you got to be built for this industry for sure. You know, I'm sure, you have to deal with a lot of the Instagram and Reels and TikTok because you're more in that generation than a lot of us, I think, you know?
One of your sauce rollout was incredible, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
You had your mom tasting it and all that. Who comes up with those concepts?
Me.
That's all you?
Literally. Like the other day, I got a DM asking like, who's my marketing PR team? And I'm like, it's me. It's literally me. I come up with a concept and I have a team of, you know, videographer and editor to like put it together. But it's like my ideas.
It's so good.
We were talking about this before you came, you and I, Roy, about how in the modern day, it's so hard to keep up with content. It's like, you were saying, if you're a blacksmith, you got to make
content. It's so true.
You make copies of keys and you have to, locksmiths have to make content, you know?
Yeah. Key shaving ASMR, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's crazy. And feels so like it applies a lot of pressure on mm-hmm. you. Do you feel that pressure content?
Oh, all the time. I mean, I have my recipe videos, and then I have the DD videos, and then I have, you know, like I have the sauce videos, yeah. mm-hmm. and then now the cookbook videos, mm-hmm. and then I have a trip at the end of the year where I take people back to Vietnam with me, and I got to promote that too. Yeah. So it's like, and I can't just always do like promotions yeah. and like
because then feeding. You have the Twaydabae videos exactly. where you're just being yourself.
And then there's right? videos of the making of the video. yeah. It's just like, yeah.
It's inception. Like, God damn.
yeah.
Oh,
I know you felt that pressure too, Roy, because you had a long rollout of all your meals at one point, just mm-hmm. like every day, whether it was like a lunch or
oh my God,
dinner.
Yes.
You were going crazy on that. You were talking to mm-hmm. me about this, like someone had spoken to you about like, you got to put some social media some more active on there.
That's my team. My team's like, you got to do something. They join TikTok or something, you know? I'm like, oh, man, the thing for me is I'm horrible when I have something or someone telling me what to do. Or like if there's like, if I have like, something that has to be premeditated or a calendar yeah. or I'm sure you have to work off a calendar or you mm-hmm. have to post it a certain thing.
Yeah.
Like I'm just more like freestyle, spontaneous. Right. And that's where I think I build the most connection.
Yeah. yeah.
So it feels very unnatural for me. I'm not afraid of, you know, doing more stuff, but it's just, it has to be natural for me. So
yeah, no, I definitely agree with you on that, because whenever I follow a schedule, I mean, I follow a schedule every day, but it's like the scheduled content just doesn't feel as connected yeah. as the like one off, like I'm gonna post this right here, right now.
Right here, yeah. right now. Yeah. That's more how I am. So I tried to make a TikTok like get ready with me type video type thing once. That shit is so hard.
What do you do to get ready?
No, because everything I do, whether it's the food vlogs that I do, everything is one take.
Yeah.
Everything I do is yeah. one take. I don't do like separate, everything is turn the camera on, whatever you get is what you get.
He's like, get ready when he puts on an apron. It's like,
<"We're done."
laughs>
<You're done." laughs> Wait, that would be so funny.
I know, but just the whole thing, but just the angles, the takes, like, you know, like remembering what to say. And it was really hard. Yeah. And then the editing after. Yes. And I don't edit shit. I just like, again, one take. And right.
You are truly one of the earliest adopters of social media. Yeah, if you look at the Twitter experience, yes. right? Like, because you
absolutely
godfathered this whole food truck. We're posting a tweet about where you're yeah. at.
We were the cavemen of social media, yeah, inscribing on walls for
that,
sure.
How did that dead. Feel like when the social media is so early? Does that feel like how things are now with social media to you?
No, I don't think it's the same feeling, because when we were out there in 2008, we were moving, everything was shifting from a stationary, because we were chat room, MySpace, Friendster based, right? Mm. Like that's where the world was. And everything was like, you had to run back home to your PC to log on and then talk to somebody.
That's right. So crazy.
It's crazy. It's crazy.
I've never experienced that.
And then you had to like devote yourself, like this podcast, you have to like go back, sit in your chair, and then like that's where you were going to be. You yeah. couldn't do like three, four things at one right. time, right? So we were in a position, and then there were no smartphones either.
Yeah.
So everything was text-based and like symbol-based. And so we were in this position where not only the iPhone came out, but Twitter came out, and everything was changing, and everything was moving mobile. So everything felt completely brand new, right. almost like it was dirt road. Like we had reached the end of asphalt, and there yeah. was dirt road.
Yeah.
And then like Bugsy, and yeah, in yeah, Las yeah, Vegas, you
exactly.
know? But wow. then now I don't feel it's like that, but I do see how it's spilled over into creating new stars. And yes. new angles. Mm-hmm. Those angles weren't even possible back then because
we weren't even pondering it.
Yeah, because there was no road.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And now that there's road, everyone's like, you know, doing street takeovers and you know,
yeah, yeah, yeah. It's gone crazy like that. Out
yeah,
there.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Crazy. Yeah. So it's different in that aspect.
No, for sure, for sure. And that's why I love the progression. This is like literally the progression yes. where I see the quality of stuff and you utilizing so much of like the resources and the quality. You know, I know a lot of like your videos, like Adrian is part of it, and mm-hmm. you know, I'm a fan of his video stuff, and you're really out there like tapping into who's doing cool stuff and actually doing it, you know?
Yeah.
Are you like...
You have to.
Do you have just ear to the streets of like web content creators and like...
I mean, the For You page is the best thing ever because it just comes to me. You know, I just see what other people are posting and like what they're doing with their channel. And it's like, hey, let's connect or let's do something, you know? Like it's... The For You page is amazing. And then once you have that check mark, they always respond to you, so.
Yeah. Have you felt any level of burnout yet of content creation?
I feel like all the time, every day. But as long as you, because for me, I film my pieces of content in batches. So like the DD videos will be filmed in batches and the recipe videos will be filmed in batches. So that's to avoid burnout because I used to do like one video every week and then post it that week too. And then the next week I'm like, I don't feel like shooting, you know? So then I realized let's do four videos in a day and then you can have the whole month free to do whatever else.
Have you also felt a rise in the popularity of Vietnamese cuisine over the past few years?
I think so, yeah. I've seen a lot more Vietnamese recipes out there now.
Right.
Yeah.
Have you seen that as well, Roy?
Especially on TikTok and with the with the younger generation, not only West Coast, but throughout the world. Definitely Banh xiao. That one's famous on TikTok. The omelet.
Yeah.
That thing goes off.
So
that's a great thing about TikTok, the hyper-specific cultural content that comes out of it. I love the hyper-specificity. Yeah. You know what I mean?
You see a lot of travel content, folks going to, you know, Vietnam and, you know, finding that one vendor. So it's not just Anthony Bourdain. It was the blueprint of Anthony Bourdain. But now you're seeing not only that one person that production was able to secure, but now you're seeing a whole
plethora. Well, I gotta say about you, because you're taking whole groups to Vietnam, which I'm like, I would never do. Like, I can say, for
let's talk about that. How big of a group are we talking about?
So the last few years, it's been like 50 or so.
50?
Yeah, this year is going to be 70.
Is there a screening process?
There is.
Okay.
Yeah. And you know, like the first few years, I didn't know what to expect, but it always came out to be a group of girls my age that shows up by themselves. Wow. And it's like, They really trust me.
They're like, this is my eat, pray, love moment.
You guys really trust me to like take you guys around. But it's really cool because these girls come and then they make friends with the other girls on the trip.
Right.
And then they stay friends after the trip. And then they, you know, go on vacations together. They meet up when they're in LA or they're in their cities. And
You're changing these people's lives. Yeah. That's crazy.
It's so cool.
You got to be built different to, I think, lead these kind of travel groups. Like for me, if my friend tells me they're gonna be in the same country the same time I am, I'm like, fuck.
What do you mean?
Chaperoning is not his forte.
I just wanna, you know, this is my trip, fam. Don't hijack my trip.
Stay on that side of the island.
Well, no, so like the reason why I wanted to make these, you know, Vietnamese recipe and Vietnamese content in the first place is because I want to showcase how cool Vietnam is.
Sure, yeah.
And so, like, what better way to showcase that to someone than to just, like, have them there and, like, breathe in the fumes and breathe in the street foods, you know?
Does the country welcome you? And now it's the second... Because I was imagining us as Kyopo Koreans trying to do a tour back in Korea. Difficult relationship with first generation, second generation in Korea.
Yeah.
But I don't see it as much in Vietnam.
No, they're so welcoming. Right. I mean, Vietnamese people are super welcoming.
Yeah.
Do you have them wear like the same colored vest like a Chinese tourist group? That'd be great.
You know, I don't, but really I do make merch. I do make them, I give them like free merch, which is cool. I call it Tour de Vietnam, but it's T-U-E-R.
Okay.
Because my name is spelled T-U-E. Well,
that's actually fire. How do you describe the country, like, of Vietnam, you know, as a whole? Like, if there's certain words or descriptions.
Because
I've been.
Maybe, like, right now it would be up and coming. Like, it's growing super, super fast. Like, really, really fast.
I think Southeast Asia for sure. Like, there's just been a focus on Vietnam and Thailand.
Man, I guess, like, welcoming, bright, colorful, delicious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Street food.
I heard Vietnam has some of the best food.
It also has huge youth culture.
Yeah. Yes.
A lot of young people doing really cool stuff. Like, if you see the Asian kids
in Vietnam, like the young kids.
Yeah.
They're like the young, cool Asian kids, like
in
LA doing shit.
You guys have gone out in Vietnam, right?
Yeah. Zoe DJs in Vietnam all the time.
I went to one of his.
I saw you in one of the IG stories. Yes. I was like, okay, cool. Yeah. I mean, Zoe's been really DJing a lot out in Asia. And whenever I visited him while he was spinning in Vietnam, and the kids that came out, I could feel the energy there.
Mm-hmm. Like, I follow a lot of like the vloggers and like the, you know, like influencers in Vietnam, and I'm just so fascinated with the way that they speak because it's not the same Vietnamese that I speak. I speak at like a grade 3 level, you know, and
they're the using all the slang.
Yes, and I'm just like, I'm just so fast. I can listen to them talk all day.
Me too. I speak at like a grade 3 level of Korean with a college professor confidence. You know what I mean? That's the thing I have. You know what I mean? And that's the great part when you have that confidence.
That's
speaking
a secret, to be honest. That's a secret sauce. Speaking the language
that confuses the like the native Koreans, like is he speaking something I don't know? What is that? You know, I think Konglish is the far more superior language than Korean and English.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Yeah. This is the Konglish,
the mutation of it all.
Yeah, for sure.
What a random question. Yeah. Is there sriracha in Vietnam?
No, there's a sauce called chinsu.
Talk to me.
And that's like their version of sriracha.
Because I can't imagine fall without the sriracha element. So what's that taste like? And part
honestly,
of my ignorance.
Sriracha is not even that good.
It's not, it's not even that good.
It's like, you know how when Gucci Mane came out, they thought they cloned him? Like people, there's like that clone conspiracy. Sriracha's not really the same anymore.
Okay, first of all, I think y'all are wrong. I think sriracha is pretty good.
I didn't say sriracha's bad. I love sriracha.
Well, you have to define the specific sriracha of Hui Fong versus
all the other ones.
So you're talking about...
I'm talking about the same one. The rooster one. The original
The color has
joint.
Changed.
The color has changed.
It's definitely different from what before.
They lost their chili contract.
Is that what it is?
But I think like even before, it just wasn't even that good to me personally because I feel like chinsu and like that type of hot sauce was better.
Oh, put me on. Like, okay, I'm gonna try it. Like, there were times when I would just squeeze the bottle.
We don't have sriracha.
When you first discovered sriracha.
We don't have sriracha at Didi.
My soup was blood red. Yeah.
I'm
dead. Was
bad. That's
how long
hilarious.
Has sriracha been in the game? It's been
a long time.
Well, this one that you're talking about, 84.
80? Wait, sriracha's been around since
you don't know
I was
the story?
Born?
Yeah, he made it for the Olympics.
Even way before.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Even way before?
I think so.
But the real stuff.
Yeah, oh,
the Hoi
okay.
Fong.
Alex, you got a date for us or what? We got a little research team here. Yeah, just.
Oh, I love this.
Mm-hmm. What do we got here? What?
84, right? Or he might have come out with it a little bit before, but he used 84 as a platform.
Yeah, it's iconic.
The iconic bottle.
The name sriracha is not even like Vietnamese. It's Thai.
Right? Yeah,
are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, it's Thai.
I think it's a Thai sauce, right?
It's a Thai sauce.
Yeah.
But is he Vietnamese? Or?
And it's more liquid.
He's Vietnamese.
He is Vietnamese. Yeah. Okay.
So confusing.
Who are some of the most famous Vietnamese people in your head? Like if you can name.
No.
Well,
in my head?
Let me say this. In America.
In America, maybe like Michelle Phan. I think she's
Michelle Phan.
Definitely up there.
Dustin Nguyen from 21 Jump Street.
So
that's way back.
Before
that's
our time.
Sorry. Cut that out.
No, we're not cutting that.
I aged myself. Sorry.
God damn. We just jumped to the 80s.
I went to the 80s.
Whoa,
sorry.
I was 21. Like, who?
No, we're cutting that.
But you're right, though. I know who you're talking about. I do know who you're talking about. It is before
Johnny Depp and on the show 21.
That's so funny.
Was he known as an actor during that time too? I feel like I have seen him in other things.
Yeah,
that
I think
time.
He came out like other roles after that. I don't think he had a huge career, but he probably got some Lifetime movies and stuff like that after that.
Is there any other names that? Oh wait, how about
I think Karrueche Tran, but she's half.
Karrueche.
Yeah.
Ki-Kwan.
Is he Vietnamese?
He is Vietnamese.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. That's definitely
that's
one of the biggest stars right there.
I mean, dude, he's so nice. I met him
recently.
Great.
He's great. Yeah. And I mean, he's been.
I could imagine both of them.
You guys like, have
you're
the
like
same,
so nice,
like...
and Keekwan so nice.
Well,
hitting each other's hands.
The cool thing about
golden retrievers.
Yeah. The cool thing about Key is like he does transcend generations.
Yeah.
Because 80s, Goonies, you know, Indiana Jones, and then now Everything Everywhere, all these roles and stuff.
Yeah.
And shout out to one of the collaborations, I think, between Koreans and Vietnamese in the recent times is The Sympathizer on HBO.
Oh, yeah.
Because it was directed by Park Chan-wook.
Yeah. Oh.
And it's a Vietnamese story. Did you see it yet?
Yeah, yeah.
What'd you think?
Your
honest feedback.
Okay, the first episode got me hooked. Mm. I was like, ooh, this is a good show. And then it went on and I was just like, it was just kind of like sleepy for me. I couldn't get into it.
Yeah. Right.
But the first episode, I was like, dang, this is crazy.
Yeah.
And then it just kind of like...
Couldn't sympathize.
But it was really cool just to see like all the actors and just hearing Vietnamese in a show like that.
I felt like that too. It did feel refreshing, I think, because we have not seen many Vietnamese shows that are through the lens of the Vietnamese people.
Yeah.
Right.
What I heard was that it's really impressive because when they were in Saigon in the first episode, I was like, wow, this looks exactly like Saigon. But then I learned that they filmed everything in Thailand because they couldn't get the permit to film in Vietnam.
Another sriracha situation, huh?
Yeah.
Crazy.
I don't know, man. These communists. You know what it's
I mean? Just... gotta keep them down, man. What was I going to ask? What kind of stories of the Vietnamese would you like to see on television or the internet or whatnot that hasn't been told? Because we hear so much about the war that, you know, and obviously it was a big part.
So much about the war.
Yeah.
I think I want to see just like, honestly, I want to see like my mom's era, like after the war, of how they were able to pick back up, of how they were able to survive, and of like just the, honestly, also from... I want to see my auntie and my uncle's like story of how they, you know, got on the boat at like 8 or 9 by themselves, came over to America and surviving, and then also bring their whole family over once they were able to. Like, how did you do that?
Right.
At 8 or 9.
The willpower,
that's
just like
crazy.
That's crazy.
It's crazy. So I want to see that, like the aftermath of the war.
Yeah, I mean, any immigrant story, when they come to this country, I'm like, damn, what would I have done?
Yeah, you can't even get out of Cato. Like, how the fuck did they get over here?
I mean, to be fair, my mom still hasn't left K-Town either. You know what I'm saying? She's like, I don't know.
I love K-Town.
What?
She did it before.
Yeah, she already did it.
But when she settled, she was like, I'm not making a third stop. No, I'm not.
Because
she actually went to Argentina first. You know, I'm one of those Argentinian age. So she went there first, came to K-Town, and was like, no, that's it.
Yeah.
Twice? You don't want to do it a third time. You know what I'm saying?
No.
But I respect it.
I kind of want to talk about the go-to spots in the city, you know? I think the viewers might want
to... I get put onto a lot of great
spots.
You're
running out of content?
I'm revisiting restaurants. Yeah. The owner's like, well, you came back? I'm like, yeah, no. Yeah.
Actually, is there any place right now that excites you in the city? Good restaurants, good cafes, anything?
There's so many that's like...
There's so many.
Yeah.
But there's a taco stand that I go to all the time.
This is what I needed to hear.
And last week, I went to it like probably 4 days in a row. But I actually don't even get tacos there.
Yeah.
I get like a rice plate. So I'll be like, can I get 3 tacos, no tortillas, with rice and piña? Yeah.
Just meat and rice.
No beans. No beans.
No beans.
No beans.
Not a beans person?
I do not like beans.
Okay, interesting.
Fucking hate that shit.
Maybe there's no beans in Vietnam.
Like, no, there's beans, but we put it in dessert. So that's dessert, why I'm like, I grew up with sweet beans.
Some Americans will say beans don't belong in a dessert. You know what I'm saying?
And that's fine. And that's fine.
I'm not saying we put beans
in that mad racist.
No, we put beans in our shit too.
Yeah.
We got red beans.
Yeah, red beans.
I'm not going to lie. And I'm known to have said pretty bad food takes on the show. That's what I'm known for.
What are you going to say?
It's
right
my
now.
Thing.
Okay.
I'm not a red bean person.
Are you
serious?
Not a big red bean guy.
Red beans, it's kind of like a...
But there
one
are moments
those...
where it has to exist.
Yes.
Like in those taiyakis.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. That's...
The fish
pastry
thing.
Uh-huh.
That gets cooked like a waffle. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If you don't have red bean in there, if you've ever had the custard one, it's not as good.
No,
right?
For sure.
Right?
I don't think I've ever had one of those.
the fish with, yeah. The pastry thing?
Yeah, no.
Yeah, we'll put
it. Damn.
I'm like, damn.
His voice got so gentle.
He was so concerned.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, wait, we gotta go.
You put beans in kogi burritos, right?
No, in the tacos por vida burrito we do, but in
but
kogi,
there was no, you guys didn't put beans in kogi
no,
burritos?
No, kogi is eggs and hash browns.
Mm. Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay.
And that's why I like kogi.
My wife doesn't like beans either.
I'm a fan of kogi.
Mm. Yeah.
How's the tacos por vida? You opened up a taco stand.
Talk to him.
Yeah. I already had tacos and I opened another taco stand, but this one was more like kogi is obviously a blending of Korean and LA flavors and right. Mexican flavors, but this one was more just like the true tacos I grew up around, yeah. You know, whether it was at the car show, whether it was at friend's house, whether it was at a party or a quinceañera or birthday party. So it was that, plus it was the team, them saying, hey, let's, can we stop using soy sauce? You know, like,
damn,
for once. Yeah, so yeah. Then I was like, all right.
They all
right.
Put it in a letter.
I was like, yeah. Oh, yeah, they put it in a letter. I miss it, man.
Going on strike.
Yeah.
No more kimchi.
No more
no
kimchi.
More kimchi.
And so that's how Tacos por Vida was born.
That's hilarious.
But, okay, but you know what? I do find interesting because I do feel like LA is having this renaissance of stands, like street food stands. And I heard this was because the licenses got cheaper or something too. Mm. Is that true? Like,
that, and I think the truck culture just changed. You know, like trucks were running things like for a while. Then COVID hit, and then in COVID it was through IG or pop-ups or you know, out of your apartment window.
Yeah,
and then that transitioned to stands as we started to come back.
Yeah. They're everywhere.
Mm. Yeah,
they're
have everywhere you guys now. Tried the stands over at Siloam Market in Thai Town?
No.
Yeah. They're in front of the Siloam supermarket, and in front of there. From like 5 to midnight, they do pad thai on the street, pad see you, mango
damn.
Sticky rice is so good.
I need to go.
There's it's a night so market good. Right near there too on Friday, Saturdays, right on like Kohanga. So Kohanga and Hollywood.
Okay.
And this one's just on Western and Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, street it's pad so thai good. Sounds so good.
Yeah, delicious. You could do that.
Yeah, that would be move.
There's been all types of stands I've been seeing, like crepes.
Yeah.
That's like, there's sometimes weird ones. I'm like, I don't know if this should be a stand.
Right. I know.
Like what?
I don't know what.
It's super lit up.
Is there something that's like a weird food item that's a stand?
No.
I'm like a banana split sundae. I'm like, wait, why is this a stand? I don't know. Like, that's an example. There's just some stuff I've seen. I can't think of from the top
of my head. You know they selling stuff on the side. You know they selling stuff on the side.
I don't know.
It's a front.
I gotta say something though. These trucks, right, huh?
Mm-hmm.
They're like... It's like album covers because the design looks so good. Some of these trucks, they look phenomenal, but the food doesn't follow through.
The trucks get over the top on it's
the
a little
top.
Like No Limit masterpiece.
Exactly.
Like mixtape level.
That's
you know,
funny.
Like,
that is the
you know,
visual aesthetic.
Yeah, the visual aesthetic of the trucks.
Because
it
draws them in. It's like the moth to the flame, you know?
Yeah.
You go there. The menu looks great. The pitch is 4K, and then you get the food, and you're like, "What? What is this?"
Mm.
I've been lied to by so many great aesthetic trucks, man.
Damn.
Yeah,
it's
mean, like Kogi. Look at Kogi. We're a white truck with like
with
a
mad
one banner.
Stickers on it.
How many trucks did you guys have? You know, at Kogi's peak.
Our peak was 5 trucks.
5 trucks.
Wow. Yeah. Now we have 4 trucks.
And was that like every time when you started with the one truck and decided to get the second truck? Was that a big deal? Just leveling up on the trucks?
Yeah. And for us, you know, our situation is very unique. Like Kogi was a phenomenon, so it was like our hand was forced. It wasn't like we sat back in a room and had a meeting and say, oh, we should grow. Like it was literally like people saying hurry the fuck up. So I was like, all right, let's get a second truck, you know?
Yeah.
And so we had to meet the demand, so that was a little different for us,
but that's a natural progression.
Yeah,
like
that was growth.
You guys did it,
but sometimes you can outgrow
too quick. Yeah,
like
exactly.
We didn't grow too quick, but it just got to the point where we met the demand. And then the demand a little bit kind of not fell off, but just like
waned a little bit
mm-hmm. or held its own. And then all of a sudden we were stuck with too many trucks. So we came back to 4.
Gotcha.
I guess that's the risk you take when you do grow, though, right?
Yeah, you got to keep pushing, you know, and see like where the limits are.
Well, why do you think the restaurant business is going through a tough time right now?
Well, there are specific reasons. Well, generally, philosophically, imagine a business where every day, because there are good sides to the business, like you get all this energy from the people coming in every day.
Yeah.
And then your cooks and you're cooking great food, you're tasting. Like there's, I don't want to say that it's all bad. There's all this stuff. But imagine a business where you have all this positive energy. Let's say you're doing concerts, sold out arenas every fucking night.
Mm-hmm.
But every day after the show, you go back to the office, you're losing money.
Mm.
So it's like this weird mind fuck of like,
right.
I'm having the most amazing moment of my life. I can't get any better creatively. But then I go back and I may not be able to pay for tomorrow. You know, so that's one. So that was already built in and difficult. And now the world just costs so much. It's never been at this point. Insurance, workers' comp, taxes, food cost, labor, all these things have gone up exponentially.
I feel like it is truly a passion project. Like, would you guys say, for both of you guys, people who do commercials, who get brand deals, like, does that generate more income for you guys than 1,000%. Your restaurants?
Yeah.
So it has to be a passion.
It's a passion.
You have
to love. But at least there was a small window where you could at least eke by before. Now that window is like...
It's very small.
Very,
it's like
almost
a little
closed.
People.
Yeah.
And we have to do things like you guys as artists. Like it can't just be record sales anymore, right?
Yeah.
We have to do other things to bring people into our whole universe.
But how does that make you feel? Do you like that? I feel like it's so hard to love that too when you're like, why can't just the food speak for itself?
I feel like it's just like one of those things where it's like there's money moves and then there's career moves. And a restaurant is more of like a career move. And like, you know, like it's something that is like going to give you that solid foundation to like build off of.
Right.
Does it give you legitimacy to think as
a
chef?
Probably. Yeah. Can, right? You know, it's like having a TV show versus...
Mm. A web show?
Oh, a web show.
A podcast.
I don't know why I did that. I didn't mean that at all.
I was like, God damn.
Sorry. I'm about to get destroyed.
Just pointing at my furniture. This is your house.
Yes.
It's a TV show set, and you have a house.
I usually never
room.
Go down this dangerous road with Doug because I know how sharp he is. But
No.
But it's like that. It's like having a TV show.
Yeah.
Maybe your other stuff is way more influential and powerful than your TV show, but the TV show somehow gives you like a foundation where others will see you in that light.
What was the original like aspirations for you both as someone who likes cooking? And I just say this because obviously what we're talking about right now, it's such a different generation. And naturally, if you were a cook, right, automatically back in the day was like, I'm going to open up my own restaurant.
Yeah.
Now it could be all sorts of things.
Everything.
So what was your first aspiration as someone who was cooking?
I really wanted to get my foot in the door to work my way up the ladder and learn from the industry and someday open up my own restaurant.
So
someday,
to get good at cooking.
Yes.
And then and just open a restaurant. Yeah, so it's pretty traditional.
Mm-hmm. Very traditional, yeah.
So, but then you just maneuvered in these different areas. People approach you about like writing a book, all those things, right? What was it for you? Was it?
Well, for me, I mean, there was no other way, you know, because I come from a different era. So I was paying my dues in the 90s as a cook.
Right.
And there was no other way. There was no other way to get out of that. The whole reason we ended up there because we couldn't make it anywhere else. So we were in this place. All we wanted to do was cook. All it was about was the craft. You know, it was like, it was just the craft. I mean, it was just early hip hop, Rakim, lyrical. Like it was just, you know, you couldn't be like
dating himself again.
Yeah, dating myself. But you couldn't like even have other aspirations because then you couldn't compete with your
you'd
peers,
yourself. Yeah,
you would dilute. Sure. People look at you like, he's not in it 100%.
Yeah.
You had to be like 120% all the time.
Nah, that purist mentality was real.
And all you wanted was, okay, I'm going to move from cook to supervisor, to lead line cook, from that to poissonier, to saucier, and then I'm going to get a junior sous chef job. And then eventually 10 years down the road, you're like, okay, I can be an executive chef, maybe.
Amazing.
That was saucier. It. That's all you had.
That's a hard word.
Saucier.
Saucier.
I might just be a saucier just to get that title.
That's
fire.
That's fire.
Tway, I would ask you, what was your decision to be like, I'm going to focus on cooking Vietnamese cuisine and that's going to be my thing?
I don't think I ever like set out to cook Vietnamese cuisine. It was just more so like that was what I was gravitated towards. Mm-hmm. And once I started making these videos, I was like, oh, I don't see a lot of Vietnamese food. Let's make more Vietnamese food and show people that there's more to Vietnamese food. And then it just kind of stuck. And I'm like, I like it here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel that. I think that's what happened with me with like focusing on a lot of like Asian creators and Asian voices.
I like how all you, the new creators, you guys all found each other as well, became friends like you and Choi and, you know, whoever else, right? Like, because every generation of Asian creatives ends up finding each other.
There's definitely a renaissance, I think, now of Asian American content creators.
That's your word today, huh?
I'll learn a new word and use the hell out of it. I will beat a dead horse down. And that was,
Twaydabae, when is just a little origin story? What was the first dish or like the first time you created something? You're like, wow, this is something I might enjoy doing. Do you remember that?
Yeah, it was in culinary school.
It was at culinary school?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was for a finals in garde manger class. And I created this dish. That's in the cookbook. It's called the honey glazed shrimp. And it was just one of those things where I was like, I've never had people actually taste something that I've just made, not from like anybody's recipe, but just made and graded me on it. And I passed and people loved it. And I was like, oh, this is cool. I want to do more.
Yeah.
So that was one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I've been trying to still get bit by the cooking bug. And I haven't yet.
Scott doesn't know how to make a ramen, man.
Yeah, at the tender age of 38, I still haven't been bit by the bug. Yeah. And I remember one time, Roy, you were on Tiger Belly, and Bobby was like, do you know anybody who cooks worse than me? And then you said, Dumbfounded.
You did?
I think so. I think he said, I don't think he knows how to make rice.
Right.
It was something to
that
effect.
Crazy.
So he ain't lying.
If you
like what? He's not.
If you can try to convince me why you think I should start cooking, like how would you, what is the feeling that I would get from it, you know?
Oh.
I love this. Self-preservation, bro. I mean, as a man, like, you know,
let's say one day
the internet goes down or something, man.
Yeah,
Uber Eats is not available. How are you going to sustain yourself, bro?
I'm going to your place.
What did you do? What did you do during the pandemic?
I did some mild cooking. I had some food videos that was pretty embarrassing.
He made fish sticks in the oven, and the fish sticks melted through the bars, and then hit the oven on the bottom, almost causing a fire.
Like, the fish sticks on like a tray.
He has no foundation, girl. He does not know. You know,
that's crazy.
Does that say, on the fish stick box? Does it say put it on the tray?
It does. Well, I mean, it shows visually.
We gotta clarify that. I'm not sure.
But you know what's crazy? When you asked them, give them a reason, they couldn't. Like, it was silent. Maybe there is there a reason for someone to learn how to cook these days, or do you think that's kind of archaic?
For me, I wanted to learn how to cook because my mom never taught me how to cook.
Wow.
But she's a great cook. Like, her food is so delicious, and I grew up eating such amazing food.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how to make it. So that's why I wanted to learn.
I saw the video where you were promoting your book and you were talking about this, how your parents never taught you how to cook.
Mm-hmm.
Was it because they were just like, get out of the kitchen, you're making it worse? Like,
yes.
you're slowing down the process.
Wow.
Yes.
That seems to be a common thing.
She's like,
was that similar?
I can't cook with my mom either.
They don't want you in the kitchen.
They don't want you there.
They don't want you there.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
They didn't want me in the
way.
House, not even in the kitchen.
Yeah. I wait outside.
Until the meal's
ready.
Go down the block. I don't want you in on the same block right now.
No,
but I do kind of understand that because once it's your kitchen, that floor plan is a choreography to it. Do you know what I'm saying?
But like, also you're in the moment, right?
Right, right.
So imagine if you're in the booth spinning,
yeah,
and someone's asking you questions.
Yeah, yeah.
You're in that space. You're in that creative space. So
your rap metaphors are hitting today. Everything is just
my Renaissance moment.
But when Donna's just going in to just, you know, refill a bottle for the baby. And then our butts just kind of hit. I'm like, come on.
Come on. You know, it's like a flow state thing, right? When you're cooking.
It is. Yeah. And then it's like, you don't want to answer questions. You don't want to slow down or take a step back. You're like full force forward because you're pushing these flavors out to the world.
Unless you're cooking with somebody that knows how to cook and like they're
have to talk.
And and there's no, you know, like you already know what you're doing. Like for me, when I cook at home with my boyfriend, it's so hard for me to be gentle and be kind because I'm just like, I just want him to like, you know, like I want to give him constructive criticism and like just show him like how to do it. But the way that I do it, I feel like I take after my mom of like, that's not how you do it. Yeah.
That's why y'all wrote a cookbook to be like, get the fuck out of my kitchen.
You know, ever since I wrote the cookbook and ever since the cookbook has gone in the house, like he's been using it more and I'm like, okay.
He's like, how do you do this? And you're like, page 47, honey.
But we also have a shorthand when we cook. Like we did a collab once about a year and a half ago and you know, and as cooks, we can already tell the moment you pick up a knife or put on your apron, I can see like
the level.
Yeah, the levels, you know. And then I had seen, I could tell that she had cooked, you know, for a while. And once we got in there, you don't have to say nothing.
Yeah.
You know,
it's kind of like, do you guys know that game Overcooked?
Yeah.
So when my boyfriend does not ever want to play with me ever again.
My girl either.
I don't even know how to play that. That's how much I don't know how to cook.
Damn.
Never cook.
I've never cooked. Not even on a game console. Hell no.
I was going to ask about Overcooked. Do you play that?
Like, I love it. Now it's gone to the point where I just play by myself. But I play two players. I switch. Serious? Yes. I'll be like, go do the dishes. And I'm like chopping. And it's a whole thing. But
Added the throw function.
Yeah. I play with like other chefs or people that have been in the kitchen, it's like silent. It's dead silent. We just know what to do.
It's like, why is Tway wearing an apron to play Overcooked? It's like she takes the game seriously.
Yeah. Hey.
She stresses out all day in the restaurant to go home to relax and play Overcooked.
Honestly, it's pretty relaxing.
Yeah. Aquafina put me on that.
Actually. Yeah, she loves Overcooked. She plays it too aggressively. It's crazy. I gotta ask you guys, there's so much food TV shows and content online, like how much of that are you guys consuming?
I think I'm consuming a lot.
Me too. Like right now I'm watching that Korean cooking show on Netflix.
Culinary Wars.
Yes.
Everyone's loving that show.
So I'm watching I mean my For You page is basically FYP, all cooking content. And then I mean, I make cookie content.
Roy was supposed to be on that show, but they said his Korean was trash.
I got called to be the host on that show. And I think I made it like almost to the final round or whatever, like right before screen test. And then they forgot to ask a question. And we had gotten pretty
far.
What
was the question?
Do I speak Korean?
They're like, one last thing before we approve you.
What? That's crazy.
One last thing.
Yeah, I thought he's like, nay.
Because you're qualified on all levels.
It hurt my ego so much.
That one thing.
Because I thought they were courting me for everything that I represent. And I thought I was going to come in there.
Right, be you.
Be me. Yeah, exactly. Like Snoop in Paris, you know?
Like
I thought I was just going to be me.
With the torch,
me.
So you assume they knew. I mean, that is a little disrespectful in a sense because they should know everything you are, too.
Like, And but going back to Koreans versus second generation. You know, I understand, but I kind of don't understand. Because at some point, you could put fucking subtitles there.
How much would you bullshit in your knowledge of Korean language, up to what point do you have to admit?
I think I'd
you
know?
You're on the set.
The interview?
You're on the set.
And you can't introduce
They can't
anything.
Even write it for
I
you?
I wish I could have created
today
that scenario.
Today we cut 오늘은 onions. Onions cut.
I wish I would have made it that far. I wish I would have made it where everyone thought I was supposed to be.
Edward Lee is at that level, honestly. His Korean is terrible.
Oh, really? On the show? This guy's the host of it?
No, he's a contestant. He's one of the contestants.
Oh, he's a contestant.
But like, there's so many cutaways where he's like, what did he say? He said kimchi.
He said mom.
Oh, man.
Oh, my gosh. Has both of you guys been around kind of doing all this food stuff for a while? I'm sure, have you been approached about food contestant things? Like, has anyone approached about being on like a Food Network?
Top Chef?
Yeah. I have, but I've only said yes to Chopped because that was the one show that I watched a lot with my mom, and I said yes to it because I wanted to come home and put Chopped on, my episode on, and just like watch her reaction. Right. That's why I said yes.
You did it already, right?
I did it already.
Did that moment happen?
Yeah. She was like, she had no idea. It was amazing.
Oh, come in the kitchen now.
No.
She's like, come in the kitchen.
I mean, since I didn't win, she's like, do not come in my kitchen ever again.
That's the thing. We do so many things just to kind of flex on our parents a little absolutely. Bit.
Literally.
So one of my decisions have been made just solely on that.
Yes.
And the truth is, I don't even really need to go on a show or accomplish those things. I could probably lie to them and get away with it.
Right.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Where are they going to fact check it?
I could probably set up a whole fake production of a show or a movie and get away with it.
Yeah.
Make a fake trailer like, no, this is coming out next year.
Yeah.
You know what's so crazy? I have a whole Vietnamese restaurant. Like, they've been in the restaurant.
Yeah.
And like, they're really proud of me for it. But the moment that really got my mom was when she saw my fish sauce in stores in Orange County. That was the moment where she shed a tear.
That's
and I was like, this is the moment.
Over the restaurant.
This is the moment that
this is it.
Really?
That's and the equivalent of the Korean newspaper.
Yes. Korean newspaper, yo.
Yeah, we always talk about the Korean newspaper, but the sauce on the shelf.
The sauce on the shelf. I could see
that's
that
a being a special moment.
Because you could flex against the people you know.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, that's why.
Exactly.
It's your community who's going to be in those aisles. Who's going to be reading the Korean newspaper.
It was really special, though, because that market was the market that we would go to every single month to get our groceries. Because when I moved to America, I moved to Oxnard.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's no Asian grocery stores in Oxnard back then. And so we would go to that market to get it. And so, like, it was a full circle moment.
So, like, in Northridge area or
Seaman? No, it was... in Orange County, it's called like the...
Oh, all the way to Orange
County. Yeah, all the way in Orange County, like Santa Ana, Westminster.
Orange County is like really coming out, coming up with the Asian cuisine, right?
Dude, and
like,
the food's so good in Orange County.
So
right?
good.
Like, I want, no one really talks about it like that because, you know, LA is a big city. But right now, I think Orange County, not chef food, but like just regular mini mall food.
Yeah.
I think Orange County is better than LA right now.
That's right here.
That's the hot take.
They need any more content creators there because they're gatekeeping something.
They're gatekeeping it.
Because I could tell when like an Orange County restaurant comes up on my TikTok, I'm like, this content feels Orange County.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There's a feeling to it. Yeah. You know?
The video quality is a little better too. I don't know what it is.
It's very
like the sun, like the lighting is a little better, you know?
I think Bob Ross has to cross the county line.
I
got to
do the whole SGV OC situation. Yeah. I want to follow Holics in 79, like the Westminster pho.
Yeah.
Next level.
Next level.
Like, I didn't even know about the flat noodle. Like, that's how they eat. You
that's
know, like
the original
pho
noodle. Exactly. Like, I came over here and I was like, this is not pho. What the hell is this?
And for me, like, you know, when pho noodle is kind of like al dente, almost harder, like, that's the wrong one. It's like, it has to be almost slurpy,
silky.
Soft,
silky.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't know. I wanted to ask you guys something. One topic that's been going around these days is the importance of the playlist at a restaurant, the music of the restaurant. My boy Sam Kim, I think from Coat, New York, there was an article that came out about that. What is a song that's a no-no? Or like, what kind of, when you dine something, has there ever been a time when like the music kind of turned you off? Or like the appetite?
Not turned me off, but early on in my, like, Dog Pounds Ain't No Fun. The unedited version.
Best friend. I feel like I'm at a like rolling
loud
concert.
When that came on, you know that. So I'm dating myself again.
No.
But there's a lot of.
I tuned out.
There's
I was
a lot
like,
of
I don't know.
Sucking this and sucking that.
Yeah.
And sucking
just like vulgar lyrics.
Yeah, vulgar
about,
lyrics
okay.
and like
sexual acts.
Sexual acts.
Gotcha.
BJs and blowjobs and penetration
and
all that
stuff.
And then coming out of the restaurant, I go, oh.
Yeah, while you're eating like a phallic piece of food.
Yeah,
like, come on.
I guess like the equivalent to that right now would be like, I don't know, if you play like Sexy Red or
Sexy
like,
Red, yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah, just
right.
where like the cursing is vulgar and graphic.
Mm.
I don't mind cursing like, if it's like
method
used in
to the madness,
yeah, the method to the madness. But if it's just like describing sexual acts in a restaurant, you know,
how are you supposed to economy with that?
Yeah, you're supposed to economy.
Is there a science to the tempo and stuff to the food that while
I think
you
it
eat?
Depends on the setting of how your restaurant is. Because like at Didi, we keep it really dark.
Yeah,
and like moody. And so the playlist is a lot of early 2000s, 90s R&B.
Yeah. Because me personally, if I go to Korean barbecue, I hate when they got like 25 TVs playing K-pop music.
Oh,
videos.
No, I can't do that.
I'm like sweating. I'm like, I got to get out of here. Know. You know?
I mean, and I can never figure out if the music's coming from the video or.
I know. I don't know. They never play the audio
from the video. Yeah.
So that was right.
I feel like that would make sense. Yes. They're playing Shaboozy country music and I'm seeing 12 girls on the screen. It's crazy.
Yeah, and they blasted. No, you're absolutely right. That might be part of the plan.
Music is very integral. What I find, my biggest pet peeve is when people want to put like their fingerprint on the music selection, but they don't invest in the sound system.
Yes.
That's my biggest pet peeve.
Yo, you know? That's so true.
Because it's not just about the song that you create, because you have to think about, you have to be a sound engineer when you create a restaurant. You have to think about the noise that's being created by the people, the kitchen, the movement, the feeling, the temperature of the space, but you also have to think of the vibe you want to create.
Yeah.
And it's not just about the song. It's, can people feel the song? Does the song fit the mood of the place?
What's another thing about opening up a restaurant that people might not know that you have to think about? Because I saw like a show or something where this lady came in and she was like, you should open up 2 more inches between the tables, like little things like that. Is there something like that you think people would surprise people how it affects the business? That's not the food.
Bro, Roy was like that. When Intercrew first opened up, they called him. And then he came through, did a walkthrough.
Yeah, he brought a measuring tape.
He had notes, bro. The trash can right there shouldn't be that close to the bathroom. Like, things like that. The napkin folding and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and us, we were like, the first time. Yeah, the first time he came through, you grilled us.
I went a little overboard. But Progress told me to go overboard. I think I went a little more.
You're good.
But it is... you have to look at all those loads because those couple inches moving the table, turning it this way or that way, you might be able, like here, you're able to get 2 spaces out of one. Right. You might be able to get 2 spaces out of one, you know?
Interesting.
Furniture Tetris and all that.
Yeah, you might be able to seat 4 instead of 2.
Yeah.
That extra 2 covers every night times 4 seatings over 7 days, you know, will equal just enough to maybe get you over the hump.
Wow.
Yeah.
Also, like, scents. Like,
oh, scents. Yeah, smells.
Smells like either candles or soaps, whether you want to do unscented soaps for you before eating and then scented soaps for after eating, stuff like that.
Yeah the first feel, the scent, the first feel when you walk in a restaurant, you shouldn't be smelling the cleaning chemicals. You shouldn't be smelling like
fabulous
house. Like a lot of buildings I walk into here in K-Town, they smell like kimchi and doenjang, right? But they look all modern, man.
Yeah.
They're supposed to be smelling like patchouli, you know, or like
Aria Casino or something, dude.
Or like Aria or Aesop or something, man.
There's definitely a lot of restaurants that you do smell the bathroom scents a lot.
Yeah, the bathroom scents a lot. That's the worst.
And I'm not talking about like, you know, disgusting, just like, you know, piss or shit or whatever. I'm talking
like bathroom
the bathroomy scent.
Yeah.
You know?
The industrial fresh scent. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Temperature.
And then that, when it's juggled with like fermented kimchi, it's a weird tantalizing, like, I hate that.
Oh,
it's
man.
Not good.
The cookbook, Dion.
Cookbook.
Yes. Oh, right here. We're promoting this. Twaydabae, go cop this. What can people expect from this book?
Oh, they can expect really easy to follow Vietnamese recipes. And
how easy are we talking?
Like, the reason why I wrote this cookbook is honestly for my little sister. I grew up taking care of my little sister her whole entire life. And so that girl does not cook. And now we don't live together anymore. And she's like 20 now and she doesn't know how to cook. So I'm like, girl, here's this cookbook.
Yeah.
Make this, and if she can make it, anybody can make it.
This is amazing. Have you made anything from here yet, Roy?
The caramel pork or the red pork.
Tikka.
Nice.
I want to ask you, so I'm when I see this, it is very, very user-friendly, and some of these recipes is like a page, you know?
Yep.
Like, it's very simple. If I went to a market, what is like the fundamental ingredients that I should have at the crib
for Vietnamese food, fish sauce and sugar. Yeah, you gotta balance it.
Cool. So like for us, soy sauce, sesame seed, you know,
lemongrass, Thai chilies. Yeah,
got you. Gotcha.
I love it. I love it. It's incredible. You can get this right now in all your local bookstores to Amazon, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
What's that one food book shop called again? Feeding it?
Now Serving.
There's Now Serving. There's Book Soup. Book Soup.
Skylight Books in Los Feliz.
Oh, okay.
Shout out to all the independent bookstores.
Yeah. Well, you can also find Roy Choi's book, L.A. Sun. That's been around. It's like probably reaching an anniversary soon, too, of some sort, right?
It did last year. It was 10 years last year.
10 years.
Didn't you wrap up your book, another book?
I wrote the book, and then 10 years went past, did an audio version of it, and now I have a new book coming out next year.
Yeah, we'll get you back on the show when the new book comes out.
I'm excited for that.
Thank you.
Thank you to my co-host Rick Lee, Roy Choi, and of course our guest Twaydabae on Instagram, on TikTok. Check her out. I love your content. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having
us. Thank you, Roy. Appreciate you.
Thank you very much, man. It's good to be back.
Yes, sir. Tune in next week for another episode of Fun With Them, y'all. Peace.